A couple times now, I've covered some Banjo-Kazooie ROM hacks. Once in a video for N64 ROM hacks, and another one where I did a dedicated video for Banjo-Kazooie ROM hacks specifically. Quite a few of the ones that I featured were created by a modder named Mark Kirko, and his work is ridiculous. He actually manages to create Banjo-Kazooie stages that really feel like true stages, not even like a ROM hack. Each of the ones that I played, though, were actually pretty short. Pretty much just one level. There was one though that I never got a chance to check out, and now that I finally have, I feel like it needs its own video. Unlike the other ones I played, this game isn't just one stage, it's an entire game. Mark took the majority of The Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time and turned it into a fully fledged Banjo-Kazooie game. And I really mean fully fledged Banjo-Kazooie game. Let's talk about it. But first, I want to take a minute to talk about this video's sponsor, Opera GX. Today's video is sponsored by Opera GX, the first web browser designed specifically for gamers. Full disclosure, this browser caught my eye a while back and looked super interesting, so when they approached me to do this, it was honestly a no-brainer. Opera GX is super easy to set up and is packed with a ton of convenient features like Discord integration, Twitter integration, and various other messaging services. And it even has Twitch integration so you can see who's live without ever navigating to the site. The homepage has a neat little section called GX Corner where you'll get some updates about upcoming game releases, gaming news, and free games. My personal favorite thing about Opera GX and what had initially got my attention was the GX control feature, which allows you to manually control how much RAM or CPU the browser uses, so it never gets in the way if you're gaming or doing other demanding tasks. And speaking of customizable options, you can also customize the look of the browser with different themes, colors, and wallpapers. And no need to worry about everything you have saved in your current browser, because Opera GX has an easy-to-use importing tool, and with a click of a button, all your bookmarks, cookies, and settings are all imported as fast as you can blink. Opera GX is also available on mobile and works seamlessly between desktop and mobile due to the Flow feature, which lets you send files, links, and notes between devices in a single click. I honestly think this browser is awesome, so if you'd like to check it out and also help my channel in the process, click the link in the description to download Opera GX completely free. It's like actually really good, so go check it out. So as I mentioned, I've played some of Mark Kirko's mods before, and they've all been incredible. The level of detail he puts into his mods is insanely impressive, and the way he manages to turn small locations from other games into Banjo-Kazooie stages, complete with all the secrets and creative thinking that goes into jiggy placement and puzzles, is crazy to me. And he even manages to throw in Easter eggs like it's going out of style. Now, I haven't finished the game yet, but I have played a whole lot of it. Definitely enough to make an assessment, and definitely enough to want to keep playing it just because of how good it is. In fact, the only reason I didn't finish it before making a video on it is just because of how long the game actually is. I went into it thinking it would be at most a couple hours, but it turned into a way bigger undertaking than I realized. So, to quickly touch on the story, it's obviously not going to be something super in-depth, and it's clearly only present as an arbitrary means to explain why the hell you're playing through Ocarina of Time as Banjo-Kazooie. But basically, Ganondorf is busy trapped in a dungeon playing Zelda 2, and Grunty took over Hyrule, so now it's up to Banjo and Kazooie to save the day. Like I said, not much to this, but we needed an explanation, I guess, so there you go. So like I said, this is pretty much, more or less anyway, the entirety of Ocarina of Time's map turned into a Banjo-Kazooie game. Each location, such as Kokiri Forest or Kakariko Village, are each their own stages, complete with jiggies, notes, honeycombs, and all the fare you'd expect of a Banjo-Kazooie game. All of these locations are interconnected, and the way they flow together is actually very seamless. I thought it would be a bit more clunky than something like Banjo-Kazooie proper, which separates each stage by actual stage entrances, but this works out much better than I assumed it would. For whatever reason, I was pretty much under the impression that because the stages were interconnected, that they wouldn't really feel separate or distinct from each other, but that wasn't the case at all. The way each of these locales actually translates into legitimately fun to explore Banjo stages is both not only shocking, but super impressive. Not every dungeon from the original Zelda game is present, but there's more than enough stages here to bring the playtime up to that of Banjo-Kazooie or Tooie. Just like Ocarina of Time, Kokiri Forest serves as both the first stage and also a tutorial area of sorts, followed by a trek inside the Great Deku Tree. Before playing, I had assumed that each dungeon would be a stage, but making normal areas that you normally mostly just walk through, like Death Mountain, and turning them into stages themselves was a really creative idea that worked out a lot better in practice than I thought. One of the coolest aspects, I think, is that if you're a seasoned Ocarina of Time player, your knowledge of Ocarina of Time's map and its various secrets often come in handy, as he tried to incorporate things directly related to things you had to do in Ocarina, like the gravestones in the cemetery, for example. For the most part, everything is pretty straightforward.
straightforward. Not overly easy, but enough to need to use some wit and critical thinking here and there to progress. It only started to stumble a bit once I got to the Forest Temple. I really don't want to give things away or spoil anything, but this stage got a little more confusing and cryptic than I would have liked, and also the camera kind of shit the bed a few times in this stage. Probably not a fault of the modder, as you need to work within the confines of Banjo's engine, but this is definitely a stage that started to feel a little bit less polished and more ROM hacky. Another thing I thought was creative was how he took some areas that may have been a bit throwaway in the original game and actually fleshed them out more and turned them into an area you both need to and want to spend time in, like the area Jabu Jabu resides in, for example. Whereas in Ocarina of Time, you pretty much just have Jabu Jabu and the cave behind him. In Jiggies of Time, though, the entire area surrounding Jabu Jabu is its own stage, and funny enough, the inside of Jabu Jabu isn't, and instead now houses Boggy's family and a cornucopia of Easter eggs. In scenarios like this, he kind of takes what you'd expect, like Jabu Jabu being a stage, for example, considering it was a dungeon in the original game, and he flips it entirely on its head. And the game sets you up to assume Jabu Jabu would be a stage too, considering both the Great Deku Tree and Dodongo's Cavern are. Instead, this area houses a different surprise, but once again, I don't want to spoil anything. One gripe that I'm always going to have for any of these mods is the fact that none of the transformations are actually unique. In certain regards, they are, like in terms of the fact that the models are different, but they basically function exactly the same as in Banjo, and pretty much all boil down to, okay, you're small now. I realize that not much can be done because you're limited by Banjo's engine, but it is a bit frustrating to superficially have new transformations, only to have them be fundamentally exactly the same. To be honest, I'd rather just not have transformations at all, considering all they really add to the game is padding. They don't really add any new mechanics as much as they just add playtime. Still, though, I do understand why they were included, but in my opinion, it doesn't really add anything to the experience and kind of slows down the pace of the game, which is otherwise super engaging. I will say, there is one part in this mod that made me want to rip my hair out, every last strand, and it's pretty early on, too. It's infuriatingly difficult, and for the record, I was playing on a real N64, so save states were not an option. Had they been, this definitely would have been a lot more bearable, but without them, this whole section made me want a cigarette and I don't even smoke. It's basically a series of slides which you need to platform between, but the physics are wonky and a lot of times when you try to jump, it just doesn't happen. And this isn't really a platforming challenge that was ever present in Banjo-Kazooie. This is kind of a makeshift challenge with unintended Banjo physics. Banjo was never a very platform-heavy game when contrasted against something like Mario 64, which was all about tricky platforming and momentum. Banjo has always been primarily about the exploration, so whenever tricky platforming rears its head in Banjo, the situation is a bit more sketchy than I'd like. I have no idea how long it took me to get this jiggy, but I definitely took a break after I finally got it. Honestly though, I don't want to complain too much because after all, this is a ROM hack, but I think the level of quality that Mark puts out in his mods is so high that I end up looking at it with the kind of eye I'd use to critique a real-ass game, and that's saying something. Most of the other challenges in this mod aren't like that slide minigame, and for the most part, they're pretty fun. And I'm not even super crazy about some of the more gamey Banjo minigames. Now, this is gonna be a short one today, because it's kinda hard for me to talk about this without spoiling a lot of it. A lot of the game's fun comes from seeing just what he did to adapt certain aspects of Ocarina of Time into the mod, as well as changes that were made, Easter eggs, and brand new content. So I kinda need to walk this fine line of telling you about the mod and pitching it without ruining it. Just listen. If you're a Banjo fan, and you're not into Banjo mods, but you're itching for a brand new Banjo game, which God only knows when we're gonna get one of those, go download this, fire it up, and have yourself a grand old time. It's every bit as fun as a real Banjo game, and if I'm being honest, I enjoy this a hell of a lot better than Tui. And if you never played Ocarina of Time and you're not a Zelda fan, it doesn't matter. It's a good game. It's a good game. Go play it. Hey, thanks for watching the video. If you liked it and want to see more, there's a couple other videos right there you can check out. And if you want to see everything I do, subscribe and then tap the bell icon. And if you want to help support the channel, I also have a Patreon right there too.